It doesn't do good to me to start my small intervention this morning. If I have to confess, I wasn't sure that I was going to talk here. I was under the impression I was going to hear a lot of experienced achievers, which will sort of strengthen my learning process and help us do what little from wherever we are. But I agree, it's also an opportunity to have information, thoughts, and your ideological commitments shared with an audience. So I take this opportunity with a very big rider that they are free-flowing thoughts, at points maybe not so coherent, but matter of fact, putting before you my understanding of what cultural nationalism is and how that is going to be the strong and the continuing glue to hold India together. If anything, over the millennia, if despite all the challenges that we've faced due to external and internal threats, the glue is cultural nationalism. And I would probably base all my remarks from my little exposure to this beautiful country in all its diversity. So if cultural nationalism, as understood from books of learning that one has read through, the essential oneness of this country stands out. That essential oneness is expressed in so many different languages and dialects. There's no doubt. But what brings the oneness? Can it be defined? Can it be plotted in some way? It is possible to plot. It is possible to physically verify. And it is possible also to corroborate in different parts of the country. So, if your cultural oneness is the sense of feeling as one entity, you would think that's a simple, straightforward understanding. Not just today, from the various oral legacy which has been transferred to us over the generation, which at some point in our history got documented, and also subsequently the interpretations given by the various scholars who came to India from outside. Different states have had different people coming at different times. So I'll randomly throw these examples only to say the cultural oneness is not something on which we need to toil. It exists, it's recorded, it is documented. But somewhere we constantly look back to say, how do we define it, how do we map it, how do we narrate it? If only we can recall continuously the various states through which this cultural oneness has been exerted, we wouldn't want to every time recall it after a search. It is before us. It is there in the room. If only we can put our finger on it every time. So broadly, do we all refer to the same elements of history? Do we all recall the same heroes of our history? Do we all speak about our land as one? We've been there, or someone of our ancestors has been there? These measures will identify and give before us the cultural oneness. It didn't surprise me because at home repeatedly we've been told about how it's the same thing here or in the northeast. It's the same thing here or in the northeast point of India. And you see that reflected in whatever you do. The kind of value systems at home, whether of frugality, whether of foregoing, whether of sacrifice is a big word, but foregoing, whether of giving back to your children what you've inherited, whether of using what you need and not more than that, playing into the hands of greed. These are virtues which have been given to us. You find it everywhere you go in India. If we can retrace these sort of things by the 32, just short years of 32 of Adi Shankara, you hear it also of the speech and from the speeches of Vivekananda, who could cross oceans and go talk about it in a different, totally different environment. Whether you, the country is geographically linked in one or the other way today or millennia ago is repeatedly proven. I constantly refer to this episode from Bhagavata, which of course is part of Mahabharata also. In that episode, Lord Balarama refuses to participate in the Kurukshetra Yuddha. He says, no, how can Krishna do this? My favorite Sishya is being troubled and this war is loaded against him, although he had a larger sainya with him. But he says, I am going on a Kshetratana. I am going on a pilgrimage. I am not interested, I will come back. When I want to come back, you get along with the war. That, if you ask me, is a revealing travel of Balarama. He goes, and everywhere he goes, he is mentioned as a part of Bhagavata. It was a kind of eye-opener for me to go into that detail. Tirupati is mentioned, Tiru Anantapuram is mentioned, and many other temples all on the way. He would describe every one of those sacred places which brings us together. In Tamil Nadu, we had a custom that every time somebody would go out of this country, recalling from the way Sri Rama went to Sri Lanka, that you would go to Kashi, absolve yourself of that extraneous influence by having a dip in the Ganga. You would get from Ganga the jal, go to Rameshwaram and have that Ganga jal used for the Abhisheka of the Lord there, Shiva, and in return collect the reth from Rameshwaram, the sand from the seashore of Rameshwaram. And of course there are one other things which I'm not adding. He would go a bit further to Dhanushkodi, remember all his ancestors, do Pindadana, and then come to Rameshwaram, collect the reth or the sand, and go back to Kashi to put that sand into Ganga. This was done in my family till my cousin brother's generation. I don't have brothers, so my brothers who went abroad would come back. The elders in the family would say, hey, did you go to Kashi? Did you go back to Rameshwaram? Did you take this much? The entire process would take a whole year, but they would do it. Linking and knitting the country together. Lord Parashurama has gone as far as Arunachal Pradesh, where Brahmaputra comes from, Tibet. And that place today is called Brahma Kund, where he is believed, and all of us have been told, believed to have relieved himself of the Matruhatya Dosha. Of course, today that may not be so relevant for us, in the sense of the sin for which he goes to absolve himself. But the fact remains that wherever from he was in the West Coast, he had to go all the way to Arunachal Pradesh. This was one linkage. And I'm very glad also to say that the Prime Minister took the special effort to recall one of the very important interlinking of country episodes. Somewhere in the Saurashtra coast, there is a place where Sri Krishna's marriage with Rukmini every year. Marriage with Rukmini is celebrated every year, and Rukmini for the Arunachal Pradesh and Northeast is a Edu Mishmi girl from Arunachal. Sri Krishna goes all the way. After the marriage, brings her to a place called Malini Tan in Assam, and from Malini Tan then comes to Gujarat. Every year that marriage happens, this year the Prime Minister rightly to reinforce that bond between the Northeast and us, had a whole delegation of people, inclusive of some Edu Mishmis, to come to attend this wedding. This has existed for millennia. And strangely, why would we want to believe this connection of Rukmini and Krishna from Arunachal Pradesh? The Edu Mishmis have two things to tell us that this so-called legend is a historic fact. The Edu Mishmi men, this generation maybe is just forgetting this, the elders, some of whom I had seen when I had gone to Pasri Ghat once, cut their hair, crop their hair in a particular fashion, recalling how Sri Krishna was about to kill him, the brother of Rukmini, but you know, ended up only taking a few locks of his hair. And remembering that, even today the elders had their hair cut only in that way. It is being spoken and said in the tourism manuals also of Arunachal. And then they had ran away from the palace in which they lived to further up the Dibang Valley to say, we'll come back only after we retrieve our girl, Rukmini, from Krishna. Of course, they couldn't ever come back there in Dibang. So these examples I quote only to say, all right, one other thing, because again, Tamil Nadu has a different approach to the whole thing. They constantly, and all of us constantly in Tamil Nadu, do refer to the Sangha literature, Sangha Tamil literature, which in many misconceptions, there's always this running debate about that being old, Sanskrit being later, without getting into that. There is a epic which was written during Sangha period, Sangha Kala as they call it, and in that epic it's of a young merchant who with his wife goes to the city of Madurai, from where they want to trade to the southeast, because the Chola and Pandya kingdoms were already moving towards the southeast, going to Cambodia, going to areas like Thailand and Philippines, which are now called that. He's come there to trade and prosper. But as they come into the city of Madura, they stay in a Ayar Kula Nagaram. Ayar Kulam is nothing but Yadavas. Ayars are those who keep cows and maintain them, allowing them to graze in pastures. When they live in that Ayar Kulam, the songs which are recorded in Tamil of Sangha era, are of Krishna's childhood, or of how these women churn the butter out of the milk and the curd, thinking of how this is what the Mathura Vasis did. And in that the famous song would be, what kind of an eye can this eye be if you don't look at Sri Krishna? What kind of ear can this be if it doesn't listen to the mantra of Narayana? What kind of tongue can it be if it doesn't recite? You know, and it goes on talking about Sri Krishna, Narayana, Mahavishnu and so on. There is a section which continuously say also of how there is sign of inauspiciousness. The butter doesn't come out. Milk is spoilt. And these women are crying, saying, what is going to befall us? Is Krishna unhappy with us? And what happens actually? This woman gets to know that the merchant husband was put to death by the king because he thought that this man, the pile that he had of his wife's anklet, was a stolen one and was stolen from the queen. And he is put to death. This lady gets to know of it, and then of course the story of Kannaki. She goes and curses the king, curses the entire town of Madura, and says, except for children, women, priests, cows, everybody should be decimated. And that happens. The reason why I'm saying is, deep down in the south, 2 millennia ago, in a literature which is very entirely Tamil, and in a state of Tamil Nadu where you constantly have this discussion about which is older, there is so much of an elaborate reference to somebody who was a native of Mathura in what is now Uttar Pradesh. So the essential oneness of India, whether you take of Northeast, the Naga princes, the Ulupi, about whom we hear so much, whether you look at Balarama's travel, whether you look at Krishna's life being recited so beautifully in deep south, we all spoke of the same kind of heroes, same kind of sacred places, same kind of value systems, same kind of natural indicators for your well-being. We were not different. They could have been in different languages. That cultural oneness is what has kept us together. But today, since we are talking about the fifth estate as the way rightly the justice is put in, culture dominated our lives. Culture was part of your households. Culture was recited in the sense commuted in families through generation. I've benefited from it. Many of my generation has benefited from it. But my fear, and with that I'll close, my fear is that commutation is not happening today by word of mouth. It may happen through WhatsApps. It may happen through some messages which are being passed. And I'm not alleging that our younger generation is devoid of culture. They are far more conscious. But the source is not us. The source is this indifferent, not so affected, lacking personal touch instruments. And is there something wrong about it? I would think yes. That brings in a certain level of loneliness in the individual. Whereas when you commuted it or transferred this knowledge, which is your inherited knowledge, on one-on-one basis, the bondage helps as you grow because you can fall back on them. Fall back on them when you have a difficult time. And that's where societies don't face immense tragedies of psychological problem, individual suffering for want of support, that loneliness which causes or leads to crimes. That is the support which is missing, for which I think all of us will have to equally take the blame. And unless this fifth estate, as Justice said, even if it is necessary for it to be the central pillar around which the other pillars, like a circus dera, is what Justice said, within the family, that centrality of that fifth estate, which was never palpably seen in a pillar, but which was passed by everybody, today is no longer being passed on one-to-one basis. It is more being passed through all these instruments. Very well, but I think we also have to be very clear that through that, the individual doesn't get cut away from our families. Family is the biggest glue for us. Cultural integrity and integralism is one very big clue to us. We have to keep both alive. I won't take more of your time. I'm sure there are excellent speeches available for all of us to hear and benefit from. But thank you to the foundation, Samskruti Foundation, for having given me this opportunity. Thank you.